Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. This is the Cortex and today we will be continuing with the chapter IGCSE CAIE biology, and this is enzymes part 2. I want to say the same thing, that this is a big chapter, so let's get on with it. If you want to know that what we will do in this video and what we did in the last video, see over here. This is the learning objective of the last video. We did all this, but in this video we will be doing all this: induced fit hypothesis, cofactors and coenzymes, and also the prosthetic groups, enzymes which catalyze the reversible reactions, enzyme inhibition, all of the limiting factors, denaturation, and past paper questions. So you should, you probably know that this will be a long video, so let's get on with it. Now, in the last video, we did lock and key hypothesis. Most people do not know about this, but this is one of the most important things about an enzyme, is the induced fit hypothesis. Now, the induced fit model is generally considered the more correct version, which means people believe that the lock and key hypothesis as compared to the induced fit hypothesis is not that true. The active site is flexible in this one. This is the active site, which means it is not initially in the shape complementary to the substrate. It means it does not match to the substrate, and unlike in the lock and key hypothesis, it completely matches, whereas in the induced fit hypothesis, it first attaches with the molecule and then it forms the correct shape as the enzyme binds to it. See, it says active site is molded into a shape complementary to that of a substrate. If you remember Play-Doh as a child, or clay, if you put it to anywhere, it would be in that shape. Like, remember molds? It is very similar to that. The active site is very flexible and it actually changes or manipulates its shape. Then it starts to apply pressure on it, which then starts to perform its catalytic function most effectively, which means it can act on more than one substrate, types of substrates. You can see over here, after catalyzing the reaction, it then comes back to its original shape, which tells us that it can catalyze even more substrates. Now, some of you might be wondering, what is this thing? This like little hole, you could say, or like little attachment. Now, this is the allosteric site. We will be studying about this in the subtopic of enzyme inhibition, so don't get confused. Just remember that in the induced fit hypothesis, the active site is very flexible and then it molds into the shape of the enzyme. And you see over here again, the same enzyme substrate complex is formed. Now, cofactors, coenzymes and prosthetic groups. What are cofactors, first of all? Cofactors are non-protein inorganic substances which are required by the enzymes for their activity. Now, so this is where the confusion comes. Before going on to here, we will see the cofactors divided into inorganic cofactors and organic cofactors. This over here is the inorganic cofactors. Now, these inorganic cofactors, which means they do not contain carbon compounds. The meaning of organic is a substance which contains carbon compounds. The examples include magnesium 2 plus ions, manganese 2 plus ions and sodium 2 plus ions. For example, manganese 2 plus ions in hexokinase, this is another enzyme. They are usually metal ions, you can see. For example, over here also manganese, magnesium, sodium, iron, zinc are all metals. They cannot be dialyzed out of the enzyme, which means that they cannot be taken out of the enzyme when they fit into the enzymes. They are needed, these all are needed by the enzymes so that they can catalyze a reaction. These are like compulsory. And the protein part of an enzyme, which you see usually, if you see, this is the protein part of an enzyme over here, and these you cannot see any coenzymes and cofactors in here, but they are attached. Like over here, there's an addition which will make the active site specific also, and it will make it able to catalyze the reaction. Now, organic factors are divided into two types: coenzymes, which are organic cofactors, and They are non-protein organic substances, usually vitamin B complexes, which are required for the activity for the enzymes. They can be dialyzed out of the enzyme, which means they can be taken out of the enzyme. These are not permanent like the inorganic cofactors. Examples include NAD, ATP, FAD and COA. For example, NAD in lactate dehydrogenase. This is just example of the coenzymes. And the prosthetic groups are tightly bound coenzymes, which means they are a part or a subpart of coenzymes. They do not disassociate from the enzyme. Example include biotin of carboxylase. Now that's just an example, but remember that inorganic cofactors and prosthetic groups do not detach from the enzyme, whereas coenzymes do. For example, a coenzyme comes to an enzyme, the enzyme without the protein part of an enzyme without the coenzyme cofactor prosthetic group is known as an apoenzyme. So remember that. So for example, a coenzyme meets an apoenzyme and then attaches with it. And then after catalyzing maybe one reaction, it then leaves, which is a great example. Now see over here about the prosthetic groups. They'll see the last line. If forced, the enzyme denatures. So which means that if they are forced to dissociate from the enzyme, they will make the enzyme denatured, which means they will make the enzyme useless. Denature means it will change the shape. And once the shape is changed, the active site is also changed, which means it can no longer bind to its substrate, which seriously makes it useless. Now this is a great example. First, let's see over here, the apoenzyme protein portion, which means the enzyme is now inactive. If an enzyme needs a coenzyme, cofactor or prosthetic group or an addition, I'm going to say right now, it means that it is inactive right now. But when a coenzyme or an addition is added, like cofactor prosthetic group, which this acts like an activator, this activates the enzyme and the substrate can now be catalyzed. Now the enzyme plus the apoenzyme is known as the holoenzyme, which means the active and whole enzyme. See, there are basically three types of enzymes which do not need any addition, such as lysozymes, and some need prosthetic groups. To act, see, the active site has changed shape. Now this type of substrate can be catalyzed. Example is flavoprotein plus FAD. Another example is the coenzyme over here, and see, it is also changed the active site, which not different substrate can bind. Example of this is dehydrogenases plus NAD. Great example, which I told you again which was lactate dehydrogenase. Enzyme catalyzes reversible reactions. What is this? This is again, we are continuing with the characteristics of enzymes. This is one of the biggest characteristics of enzymes. Most reactions in living cells are reversible. Therefore, enzymes catalyze reversible reactions, such as the oxidation of glucose and photosynthesis in plant cell. See, enzymes, it tells us this, and most reactions in living cells are reversible. Because enzymes are biological catalysts, they are present in living cells, which means that therefore they will catalyze reversible reactions. Great example is the oxidation of glucose and photosynthesis in a plant cell. See, here you see with the arrow coming over here, it is photosynthesis, but when reversed, it is cellular respiration. So this you can see that it is reversible, and the basic form for it is A plus B and then an arrow going both ways, C plus D. These are basically the products. Enzyme inhibitors. This is a huge part. What are enzyme inhibitors? Enzyme inhibitors are substances which alter the catalytic action of the enzyme and consequently slow down or in some cases stop catalysis. There are three common types of enzyme inhibition: competitive, non-competitive and substrate inhibition. Let's see first the competitive inhibition. This is an enzyme. Remember this, I told this, that this was the allosteric site. We will see what those are. When an enzyme and a substrate and an inhibitor, this is a competitive inhibitor, which means it competes for the active site. It then comes and fits into the enzyme. This is the active site, the upper, the triangle like, and this is the allosteric site. We will learn what those are too. See, What it does, it blocks the active site. Now this substrate can no longer enter, which means it binds to the active site, which no reaction can occur because it has blocked it, and substrate can enter the active site or attach to the active site, which means no substrate complex can be formed, enzyme substrate complex. Now in the non-competitive inhibition, you see this is the enzyme. Now remember, I'm saying again and again, the allosteric site, the enzyme and an inhibitor. This is also known as an allosteric inhibitor because it comes and inhibits the allosteric site. See, it binds to the allosteric site, which then applies pressure onto the active site, and then it changes the shape of the active site, which means that now this substrate cannot even attach to this, and no enzyme substrate complex can be formed. This, it says over here, inhibitor binds to the active site, which means no reaction can be formed. Changes in the shape of the active site. Over here, it directly blocks it, but over here, there's a change of shape. Now, it is substrate inhibition. This might be kind of weird for some people, but this is a huge thing. Now, this is an enzyme. These are all of the substrate floating. Now, because in some solutions, there are so many substrate that they even start to block the enzyme, which means it makes it useless. They will see it blocks it and they are not even trying to enter it, which seriously affects the rate of the catalysis. Limiting factors. Yes, one of the most confusing things and one of the most interesting things in this chapter. Now, what are limiting factors? Any factor that directly affects the rate of reactions at which a process such as a chemical reaction occurs, if its quantity is changed, is called a limiting factor. This means that a factor which affects a rate of reaction, if the quantity has been changed, if a magnitude of something changed, which can affect the reaction. For example, a chemical reaction. The value of this factor has to increase in order to increase the rate of reaction. See, this is, for example, a limiting factor. It can only be filled up to here, but then it cannot, which means the height or the capacity of it is becoming the limiting factor. Now this is the first limiting factor. All enzymes have an optimum working temperature at which they work best, which means enzyme will catalyze a reaction best at a specific temperature. An enzyme is inactive at low temperatures, which means there is a temperature range of an enzyme. If, for example, this is the optimum temperature where it works best, over here in the yellow part, but it goes down to here the temperature, which means it will stay inactive. Now it will not even catalyze any reaction. Slowly it will increase and reach to here, which means it will catalyze the best and the fastest. It will work fastest and catalyze most reactions in less period of time. It will catalyze temperature even quicker in shorter period of time in a higher temperature. As temperature rises, the rate of reaction increases because heating leads to increase in kinetic energy of molecules. This means that this leads to more successful collisions and more formation of enzyme substrate complexes. So basically, when temperature is increased, for example, to this orange part, the heat energy will be converted into kinetic energy, which means the substrates will then move faster around, and eventually they will collide with an enzyme, which they will bind to, creating an enzyme substrate complex. Usually the activity doubles for every 10 degree centigrade right in temperature. So for example, this is a 10, this is 20, this is 30, 40 and 50. These are 10 at intervals. It will be inactive over here, but then over here it will be active and doubled from its activity over here. But it will be even doubled over here, and even doubled over here, and even doubled over here, which means, yeah, it will be more faster. If there is increase in temperature from optimum temperature, for example, at this yellow, this bar 30, for example, is its optimum temperature, the activity of it will slightly slow down. For example, until here, this line at the 40 mark, it will slow down, but it will still work. It will slow down until a point it reaches, point usually 60 for some enzymes, but obviously each enzyme is different. It requires different things. Where it denatures, which means its activity is destroyed. We will learn about denaturation. Basically, know that in denaturation, because it's a protein, it will coagulate, or it will kind of change its shape. When an enzyme changes its shape, its active site is also altered, which means it can no longer bind to a substrate and create enzyme substrate complexes. For this is the temperature at which it denatures. If it crosses it, for example, it crossed it, now it will denature. And now the sad thing is, it is destroyed. Even if the temperature is brought back to the optimum temperature, nothing will happen because its shape has permanently changed. Amylase, for example, works best at 40 degrees centigrade and denatures at 60 degrees centigrade. For example, I over here, this is denatured because there is no, you can see, rate of reaction, and slowly it increases, which means it doubles. For example, 10 degrees centigrade increase till here, its activity is doubled, then doubled over here, then doubled, then doubled. You see at K, it means that this is its optimum temperature because it's the highest rate of reaction, you can see over here. But then the temperature increases and it slows down, slows its activity, slows until it denatures over here, which means stands for D, too much heat. pH, which means power of hydrogen. Enzymes are greatly affected by the acidity and alkalinity of a solution they work in. Enzymes like pepsin in the stomach work in acidic solutions, trypsin in the small intestine work in alkaline solutions, and amylase in the mouth work at neutral solutions. This tells us that different enzymes require different pH. In the figure below, at point M, the activity of enzyme is at its peak as it is its optimum pH. See, as it decreases, its activity slows down until 4 pH. Sorry. Over here, it activity slows down over 4 pH and then it's completely denatured, which means unlike the temperature, in temperature when the it decreases, it gets inactive at low temperature, whereas in low pH it gets completely denatured. And same when it reaches in front or more pH, which means at 9, this completely denatures. Now, what enzyme is this? Remember these pH levels and the temperature also. I told these are all of amylase. This can come in the paper. Now, the last limiting factor, substrate and enzyme concentration. At low substrate concentrations, collisions between enzyme and substrate molecules are more frequent and reaction proceeds slowly. Which means that because in low substrate concentration, there is a low amount of substrate and a low amount of enzyme substrate enzyme substrate complexes are formed. As the substrate concentration increases, the rate of reaction initially increases proportionally as collisions between enzyme molecules and substrates become more frequent. This means that as the substrate increases, the enzymes which are yet not doing any reaction or aren't catalyzing any reaction, they also start to form enzyme substrate complexes, and then there's a higher rate of reaction. You can see when an enzyme concentration increases, the rate of reaction will obviously increase because the enzyme will bind to even more substrates. Whereas when substrate concentration increases, it will increase until a specific time where it will not. See, a specific enzyme will only will increase the rate of reaction till X. The temperature is constant. See, it is only increasing it at X and it is not further doing anything. But when there is a higher concentration of enzymes, it is doing more. At Y and at Z, you can see it is increasing the rate of reaction. Why do enzymes become denatured? Now, what is denaturation first? Denaturation is the three-dimensional structural change produced in any enzyme or soluble protein by mild heat or various chemicals such as acids or alkalis, which make them coagulate. In enzyme, this destroys their activity. Coagulation is basically the change of shape. As enzymes are made out of proteins, it undergoes a significantly high temperature of pH. It starts to develop change in its shape and becomes insoluble. Because a denatured enzyme is insoluble, the hydrophilic bonds or the hydrogen bonds are broken because of the uneasy conditions on the enzyme. The three-dimensional shape is altered and it coagulates, which will stop the reaction as the shape of its active site is also changed. which brings changes in its surface configuration. Now, what is the surface configuration? The shape of its active site, which perfectly fits to its substrate. You can see the denature enzyme is not fitting to the substrate because it does not match. See, the suitable substrate can no longer attach to the enzyme as all hydrogen bonds break and it becomes useless as it can no longer catalyze reactions. This is irreversible change, as once it coagulates and its active site loses the suitable structure, it can no longer come back. Now see, this is the native state, which means the normal state. This is an enzyme, the protein chains, but when it denatures, it becomes abnormal, you could say, because it changes its shape. But as a native state, which is the opposite of a denatured state, it does catalyze. Unlike in here, the active site is destroyed. For example, this is the active site and it is changed over here. It can no longer catalyze the molecule or the reaction. Now, these are the past paper questions. A dish is filled with agar jelly containing starch. Four holes are cut in the jelly and each hole is filled with different substances as shown. Which hole is surrounded by the largest area without starch after 30 minutes? Now, what is agar jelly? It's basically a kind of jelly which has a solution which is used inside the laboratories for carrying out different experiments. Now, in here is the amylase solution. In here is the hydrochloric acid here, which is a very strong acid. Boiled amylase solution, which means high temperature, and distilled water. Remember, when a substance is boiled, the temperature is almost like 100 degrees centigrade. What is the answer? Tell it to me down in the comments below. In 1, 2, 3, it is the amylase solution, because if it is put in hydrochloric acid is very strong, so due to the pH it will denature. Same with the boiled amylase solution, it will denature. And in the distilled water, if there is no enzymes, what will catalyze the reaction? So it left as amylase solution. Protease enzyme breaks down protein into amino acids. In the lock and key hypothesis, what is the lock and what is the key? Now tell it to me in the comments in 1, 2, 3. It is the lock is the protease and the key is the protein. Amino acid is the product, but protein is the substrate. Remember that. This is a huge question. The diagram shows an experiment on amylase. Each beaker contains water at the temperature shown. After 5 minutes, each test tube of amylase is poured into the test tube of starch solution in the same beaker. After leaving the tube for 5 minutes, samples of the mixture are tested with iodine solution and then again tested after 5 minute intervals. Which results are expected? Please tell it to me down in the comments below. Just telling that this is the starch solution and this is the amylase solution in all of these, and these are the temperatures, but this is ice. This is the answer. At 90 degrees centigrade, it is blue black. If you don't know, iodine solution actually signifies that the reaction has occurred, because blue black means it occurs. At 90 degrees, it tests for starch. It stands for starch, not for sugars. Amylase breaks starch down into sugars, which means that starch is present, because at 90, the amylase denatures at 60. It will no longer even work at 90. In 35, it goes yellow-brown immediately, which means that at 35, it is the optimum temperature, so it works. Goes yellow-browns after 5 minutes, because 20, though, is not its optimum temperature. It does still work, but does take time. Blue black after 30 minutes, because it does take time, a lot of time, to catalyze the reaction. Now, four test tubes containing 10 cubic centimeter of 1% starch solution were treated in different ways and then mixed with saliva. After 30 minutes, 1 cubic centimeter of iodine and potassium iodide solution was added to each tube. Iodine, it converts starch into sugars. In which tubes were the contents a yellow brown color? Now, tube incubated at 75, pH 2.5 and pH 6.9. Just to make it perfect, the optimum temperature of amylase is 35 and it denatures at 60, whereas the optimum pH of the amylase is 7. It denatures at 4 or 9. It is B. Because the tube incubated at 35, it is the optimum temperature, and same with the tube incubated at 6.9. This is very close. That's why this occurs. The diagrams represent an enzyme molecule and its substrate. Which diagram shows these molecules after they are heated to 100 degrees centigrade? Now, when they are heated to 100 degrees centigrade, which means they have probably denatured. Now, what is this? It is C, because an substrate never denatures, or an enzyme denatures. A substrate, we do not say a substrate denatures, it is protein, but we do not consider that. You see, this is its normal, but in the others, it cannot even fit together. See over here, because it has been denatured. Thank you for your support. This was a great. I love making videos, and bye. Bye.